Today I'm going to read a short biography about Eleanor Roosevelt. After I'm done reading, I'm going to attach some questions for you to answer. I hope you enjoy this book as much as I did. Eleanor Quiet No More, The Life of Eleanor Roosevelt, written by Doreen Rappaport and illustrated by Gary Kelly. Eleanor's father adored his little golden hair. They talked, she danced for him. He hugged and threw her into the air. He made her feel important and loved. But he wasn't home a lot. Eleanor's mother thought Eleanor was not so pretty and way too serious. She called her granny in front of people. Eleanor tried to please her mother by being good. It didn't work, so she just kept quiet. I wanted to sink through the floor in shame. Eleanor's parents died before she was 10. She and her brother went to live with their grandmother Hall and two aunts and two uncles in a big, dreary house. Her grandmother did everything she thought was right for a little girl, except hug and kiss her. She hired a governess who taught Eleanor how to cook and fold socks and towels. A dancing teacher taught her how to waltz, and a French teacher made her memorize parts of the Bible in French. I never smiled. When Eleanor was 15, she was sent to school in England, as girls from rich families often were then. Her teacher, Marie Silvestri, talked and talked about history. She made Eleanor read all kinds of books in many different languages. She told Eleanor to read and think for herself, to find important things to do, and to speak up for what she believed in. She took Eleanor traveling and let her walk about Paris by herself. Most girls in this era were not allowed to go out alone. Eleanor began to feel more sure of herself and made many friends at school. She shocked me into thinking. When Eleanor was 18, she came back home. She worked with other wealthy women who thought it unfair that they lived so well while some Americans had so little. Eleanor was shocked to see 4-year-old children making artificial flowers in dark, dingy apartments in downtown New York City. It horrified her that children were working instead of playing. She knew she had to help them. She went downtown to teach. Very early, I knew there were men and women and children who suffered. Sometimes Eleanor's classes met at the same time as the parties uptown. Grandmother was not happy. She wanted Eleanor uptown where she could meet a proper man to marry. Grandmother Hall should not have worried. A rich, distant cousin named Franklin Delano Roosevelt loved Eleanor. He thought she was smart and honest and caring. He loved that she listened, for most people only pretended to. He asked her to marry him. She wrote to him, "I am so happy in your love, dearest, that all the world has changed for me." Franklin made Eleanor happy, but his mother, Sarah, didn't. Sarah told Eleanor what clothes to buy and what food to serve. When Eleanor's children were born, Sarah told her how to raise them. She built Eleanor and Franklin a house next to hers with connecting doors on all floors. She even chose their furniture. I had nothing to do with it, and it is not the house I would have got. I hate it. As unhappy as Eleanor was, she was too afraid to speak up. In 1911, Franklin was elected to the New York State Senate. Eleanor packed up the family and moved to Albany. She liked Albany, especially since Sarah didn't live there. Eleanor learned about government. She listened to debates in the Senate. After she put the children to sleep, she listened to Franklin and his friends talk about politics. Eleanor was a good wife for a politician. She knew when to ask questions and when to keep quiet. It was a wife's duty to be interested in whatever interested her husband. Two years later, Franklin got a new important job in Washington, D.C. Eleanor packed up the family again. For 4 years, she was busy raising their five children and going to fancy parties. Then, America went to war. From early morning to midnight, Eleanor organized women to knit warm clothes for sailors and make coffee and sandwiches for men going off to war. In a naval hospital, she saw men too wounded to ever go home. Some were shell-shocked and locked behind bars. They had no one to talk to and nothing to do all day. Eleanor was outraged. This time, she didn't keep quiet. She hounded public officials until these men got the best care. What one has to do usually can be done. World War I ended in 1919. 2 years later, Franklin came down with a serious disease called polio. The doctor said he would never walk again. Sarah said Franklin must stop working and move back to the family home in Hyde Park. Eleanor knew he dreamed of holding public office. She had to help him realize his dream. Sarah was furious with her and tried to turn Eleanor's children against her. But no matter what Sarah said or did, Eleanor held firm. This was the most trying winter of my life. Franklin slowly recovered. Meanwhile, Eleanor was very busy caring for their five children and teaching history and government in a girls' school in New York City. Her life became more separate from Franklin's. A women's democratic group asked her to speak. She worried she might not be able to stand up, let alone talk. "You must do the things you cannot do," she said. Soon she was making more speeches and talking on the radio and writing magazine articles. She reminded women who had recently won the vote that they had important things to do. "Women must get into politics and stay in," Eleanor said. In 1927, Eleanor campaigned for Franklin when he ran for governor of New York, urging women to vote for him. Franklin won. Eleanor campaigned even harder when he ran for president in 1932. He won that election, too. Eleanor was now first lady. Hundreds of Americans wrote her about what she should and should not do. But Eleanor knew she had to do and say what she believed in. Everyone must live their life in their own way. These were hard times in America. In this era called the Great Depression, millions of people were out of work. They had no money for food or housing. Americans were very scared. Franklin sent Eleanor around the country to talk with them. She visited coal miners and veterans and sharecroppers. No first lady had ever done that. She told Franklin what she saw and what she thought needed to be done. Government has a responsibility to defend the weak. Life was especially hard for Black Americans. The South was segregated by race, and so was Washington, D.C. Eleanor shocked Southerners by having a party for Black girls at the White House. The Daughters of the American Revolution refused to let the great Black contralto, Marian Anderson, sing in their auditorium. Eleanor resigned from the group. To remain a member implies that I approve of that action, she wrote in her newspaper column, and millions read her words. She arranged for Anderson to sing at the Lincoln Memorial. More than 75,000 Americans, Black and white, came to hear her. In 1941, America was at war again. Franklin sent Eleanor across both oceans. She traveled thousands of miles and met over 400,000 men and women. She walked miles in hospital wards, stopping at every sick bed. "What is your name? Is there anything you need? Can I take a message home for you?" And the military leaders who had not wanted her to come saw happiness and hope return to the face of their nation. All through Franklin's presidency, Eleanor spoke up for what she believed in. She insisted all Americans deserve decent housing, health care, and education. She spoke out against racism and anti-Semitism and the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II. Many Americans hated what she said and what she believed in. They mocked her. They called her ugly and do-gooder. But no matter what they said, she refused to keep quiet. Do what you feel in your heart to be right, for you'll be criticized anyway. Franklin's health gradually weakened. He died just at the start of his 13 years as president. Eleanor was 60 years old. The story is over, she told reporters, but Eleanor's story wasn't over. President Harry S. Truman appointed her to the United Nations. She headed a committee of people from different countries. Many had different ideas about freedom and religion and human rights. We must be able to disagree and to consider new ideas and not be afraid. Eleanor listened and talked and argued. After 2 years, the committee agreed on a Declaration of Rights for people all over the world. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. Eleanor was busier than ever. When she wasn't visiting with her grandchildren or writing her newspaper column or lecturing or writing her life story or telling politicians what to do, she circled the globe. She met with world leaders and with people like you and me. The First Lady of the United States had become the First Lady of the world. We have to continue fighting for freedom of religion, freedom of speech, and freedom from want. Roosevelt died at the age of 78, and the world mourned and praised the woman who refused to be quiet. I have never felt that anything really mattered, but knowing that you stood for the things in which you believed and had done the very best you could. The end.